You see, while Miss Mississippi sang, Miss New York used a plastic red cup.
Yeah, guys, this is always a huge event in Vicksburg, and if you don't believe me, all you have to do is look at the front page of the newspaper.
Very bizarre, Stephanie. That Jackson woman says someone slashed her tires and then left a note on the windshield of her car.
Yeah, Darren, that surveillance video shows the gunman used a bag like this to stuff the cash in when he robbed the Dollar General store here on Highway 80. Neighbor right across the street from that house we showed you earlier says he did not escape storm damage. This tree fell from his neighbor's yard and landed straight on his front porch. You can see the damage. Take a look over here at some of the shrubs closer to this fountain. You can see where water has frozen on top. That current state law says if you're transporting students to and from school, those yellow buses are not allowed to go any faster than 45 miles per hour, 50 if they're on a school trip. But in order to do this interview, we're gonna have to kick off our shoes.
Thanks, David. Live at 5, a classic car heist caught on camera. It happened at a crowded gas station on Capitol Street. And Mississippi held its first ever tax-free gun sale this weekend, but not everyone was happy about it.
Try Jesus, not gun.
Back here at home, a Brandon's shop still closed this morning after police say a woman may have blacked out and drove her truck into the store.
Well, it was just a little boom.
That boom was the elderly driver going through the front window. It happened at Julie's Boutique on Government Street Friday.
That's right. It is 5:56 this morning. We're also keeping an eye out on Jackson's airport, where Miss Mississippi is getting ready to head to Atlantic City for the Miss America pageant. We have a crew there as she departs this morning. Megan, this is a really sad story, but take a look. Family friends gave us this photo here of Darius Willington. Now, that friend says Willington was on the football team, and he collapsed during track tryouts.
That's right, Keegan. There's at least three boats right here on the water between the spillway and Madison Landing searching for that 53-year-old man that went swimming late last night, jumped off of his boat, and never came out of the water.
And while we tried to shoot video for this report Wednesday, a box truck slammed into the bridge again.
911, what's your emergency?
Yes, ma'am. This is Tammy with Channel 16. I'm on Gallatin and Porter Street in Jackson. A rider truck just hit a bridge. It takes almost my entire body up on one side. And then as you look a little bit further in, you can see where the tree is actually slammed up against this roof.
This is cell phone video of the aftermath.
Oh, my.
One woman barely escaped when this black SUV fell off a car carrier and smashed onto her car on Interstate 55.
Take a look at what's left of this SUV after it fell off of an 18-wheeler and slammed on top of a Toyota Camry. And what did it sound like?
Like D-Day or something.
A 4,000-pound SUV falling at least 10 feet down into traffic moving at least 50 miles per hour. Before he left the scene, we flagged down the truck driver who lost that SUV from his trailer load. Tony Izaguirre says he's rattled, but he told us he's more worried about the woman in that smashed Toyota Camry car.
I was more concerned with the lady.
More concerned for the lady?
My heart was pumping like you can't imagine.
The truck driver says he was driving on Interstate 55 to take auction vehicles to Texas. Investigators say the truck's trailer was elevated too high. The Nissan Xterra on the top of the trailer slammed into the bottom of the bridge.
What happened?
It was not low enough, and I guess it when it hit, since I didn't have cars in the back, so it just blew out.
Did you know that the truck had fell off?
I heard the pop. Yeah.
Did you feel like the bridge wasn't high enough?
No, the bridge was high enough.
Okay.
It was my fault.
Okay.
Yeah, it was my fault. I didn't lower enough.
Traffic backed up for miles on I-55 while police did their investigation. With wall-to-wall traffic, it took more than an hour to clear the crash site.
State police say no one was inside of this SUV when it crashed on top of that Camry, but take a look at the Camry. They say that a female driver did have to be transported to the hospital for her injuries. In Jackson, Tammy Eswick, 16 WAPT News.
A new bill at the state capitol says school buses need more speed. This month, the House passed a bill that would allow bus drivers to go the speed limit. Wait, What?
School buses are not permitted to run over 50 miles an hour, regardless of where they're going.
That current state law says if you're transporting students to and from school, those yellow buses are not allowed to go any faster than 45 miles per hour. 50 if they're on a school trip.
That means if a bus is going the highway speed limit on Interstate 20 or 55, they are breaking the law. Drivers we talk to say it's hard on them.
You got to keep up when you get on the interstate with these buses. If you don't, they'll run over you.
The penalties are stiff. Get pulled over and you not only get a fine, but you could lose your license. Representative Ken Morgan says a bus driver from his district brought the law to his attention, and he thinks it's outdated.
Basically, all we're asking for in this bill is to go back to whatever the posted limit is.
I think that the average parent in Mississippi today would fall out if they knew that their children are going to be allowed to be transported on these buses.
Representative Amaria Scott says she thinks the bill is a bad idea, and she says she voted against it.
Now, children would be out here without seat belts on, going whatever the speed limit is. If they're out there on Highway 49, 65. If they're out there on Highway 59, 75.
When we asked one mother, she had mixed emotions about the idea of faster buses.
Well, I don't really think that's too bad if the bus drivers are responsible.
But she changed her mind when she thought about buses driving that fast without seat belts.
That big of a vehicle and going so fast, the bumps and the, you know, that is still a concern from parents.
So if you voted today, what would you vote for?
I probably would vote no.
What about some of the buses that don't have seat belts?
I don't have seat belts on my bus anyway.
You don't think that's kind of dangerous for the kids?
Maybe they'll sit down.
No, they shouldn't. Not with our kids.
So when do you think we might get to the seatbelt portion of this?
I feel like it may come up during the session.
Representative Morgan says they haven't seen everything that the House and Senate are working on this session. But he says there's a good possibility someone will come up with a companion bill on seatbelts. In Jackson, Tammy Eswick, 16, WAPT News. Imagine this, a water bill for one house in one pay period, $1,700. Another family brought us a bill for $6,000.
My husband opened it up and went into shock, and then he showed it to me and I went into shock.
The WAPT employee with this bill told us he knew water rates are supposed to go up, but from $200 to $1,700 seemed a little drastic.
The question we have basically is, who's accountable for this bill?
Ultimately, the city would be accountable for the bill.
It's just a drop in the bucket.
How much is your bill usually?
About 90.
This month, Shamika Hearn's bill is over 100. She blames a leak at her house on Casablanca Drive. She says city water is flooding her yard and driving up her bill.
My meter is leaking, and they said they were going to send someone out because they said it could be the new meters that they installed.
That family with the $6,000 bill didn't want to be on camera, but they did know one thing had changed.
Then I remembered they had changed out the old meter, and I immediately knew it had to be a mistake.
As you know, with the Siemens contract, it's a work in progress. So, we're concerned that residents are getting bills like this.
In June, a company called Siemens started updating old water meters for a digital upgrade.
They'll tighten these up to secure a no drip situation, no leaks. And then they'll turn the water back on.
Back then, the mayor talked about how the project should make things more efficient.
We know that in several places that there are breaks that are under the ground that we can't readily identify, but we do know that we lose that water. But this gives us an ability to be able to measure and monitor specifically at our homes to see what's going on with that water.
The city has been passing out pamphlets that claim as meters get older, they may not measure all of the water you use every month. That's why earlier this year they warned that some people could see higher bills with the newer and supposedly more accurate meters. But from $200 to $1,700, the city admits something went wrong. We found out through the city that the man with that $1,700 bill has an old meter on the house.
After an investigation, we determined that it was caused by a glitch.
Now, what type of glitch are we talking about?
Well, we're still reviewing it, but it seems as if the reading was off.
Now the city says they've sent him a new bill for $120, a drastic difference.
We want them to contact us as soon as possible when they get bills like this so we can determine what the cause of it is. Is it because of the meter installation? Was it because something was misread? And as soon as they can notify us, then we can find a corrective solution to it.
Contractors are still working to replace almost 65,000 meters across the city, while Jackson continues to fight to fix its water woes. We've shown you where that problem started before: aging water pipes that have been in the ground for 8 decades. They've been ruptured and shaken by Yazoo clay, and they've been cracking and leaking for years. Now that battle to fix an aging infrastructure is continuing to cost customers. In Jackson, Tammy Eswick, 16 WAPT News. The story is spreading like wildfire, how Walter Williams woke up from the dead in Holmes County.
I asked the coroner what happened. He said, "Oh, they can call us a miracle."
I stood there and watched them put him in a body bag and zipped it up.
The coroner says he checked the pulse around 9 o'clock Wednesday night and pronounced Williams dead at his home in Lexington with no heartbeat.
That was 10:30. And at 2:30, my cousin called me and said, "Not yet." I said, "What you mean, not yet?" He said, "Dad is still here."
After the coroner helped move Williams to Porter and Son's funeral home, workers were getting ready to embalm him. But that's when he started to move.
He was not dead, long story short.
Byron Porter says it's the first time he's ever seen anything like it. A man inside a body bag kicking to get out.
So he missed it by how much?
I don't know.
A couple of minutes, maybe?
No. More than that, maybe. Well, we definitely was not going to do anything to him. And
once you saw that he was
right,
alive.
That he was not deceased. Right.
Paramedics rushed Williams to the hospital, where tonight family members say they're happy he's alive.
Now, I don't know how long he's going to be here, but I know he's back right now, and that's all what counts.
In Lexington, Tammy Eswick, 16 WAPT News.